The morning sun shines on the gleaming hide of a muscular ranch horse. The aroma of bacon and coffee drifts from the wood cook stove at a cow camp. Silver spurs jingle as the men and women of the West get set for another day in the saddle. From the heart of Canada's finest ranching country, this is the Spirit of the West with rancher and horse trainer Hugh McLennan and his collection of music, poetry, and conversations with the folks who live and work with horses and cattle in the Spirit of the West.
Some of us who grew up watching our silver screen cowboy heroes had aspirations of being singing cowboys when we grew up. Well, maybe when I grow up, that's what I'll try and be. This week, you're going to meet a guy who made those dreams come true for many years. He led the trail rides in the beautiful Sierra Nevada mountains of California by day and entertained the riders around the campfire in the evening. Something like a California version of Wolf Carter. His name is Rich Price, and you'll hear his stories and some of his songs today.
We'd ride sometime 32 miles a day, and it was the equivalent of 3,000 miles a summer. It was like getting on a horse in San Francisco in June and getting off in New York in September.
Well, on some outfits by now, the last calf has hit the ground, and Baxter Black looks back at what can go wrong in the heifer pen.
Pulling calves is always chancy. Like you're playing slots in Vegas. Put your hand in, pull the lever, double front feet or the head back, nothing coming but the tail.
And we have a lot of valuable information on the Rangeland News, including this item.
Beef production rises, retail prices drop by over 6%.
In the Cowboy Poetry Spotlight, one of my very favorite writers and reciters, Davy Longworth.
Now the peeler on this place was a man of quiet grace. He rode them all, wasn't prone to wrecks.
On the Urban Saddles and Western Wear Horse Training File, I'll look at the right way and the wrong way to use your hands on the reins. And a song that's always a favorite for our Spirit of the West cruise gang and our sing-alongs on the ship will be in our classic song segment, and I'll see if you can guess who will be singing it. And Rich Price talks about his amazing life in the saddle after he gets us going with one of his own compositions, and talk about musical talent on this one. The famous Jordan Ayers, Charlie McCoy's harmonica, Joey Miskelen's accordion, just to name a few.
You'll find it in the West.
Have you ever seen a snow-capped mountain that reaches up to the sky? Have you ever been among green pine trees while a river keeps rolling by? Have you ever held her hand and kissed her on the trail that I love the best? If you're still searching for heaven, my friend, then you'll find it in the West. Have you ever felt the splendor on top of peaks of granite gray? You can almost caress the silver clouds as they gently sail away. Have you ever loped along at twilight on the trail that I love the best? If you're still searching for heaven, my friend, then you'll find it in the West. Ever seen the rainbow at the foot of a waterfall? As the white mist pours over granite gray, it will thrill you one and all. Have you ever kissed her high above the valley that I love the best? If you're still searching for heaven, my friend, then you'll a snow-capped mountain that reaches up to the sky. Have you ever been among green pine trees while a river keeps rolling by? Have you ever held her hand and kissed her on the trail that
Rich Price, the trail riding, singing cowboy on the line all the way from California.
Can't wait till we do this in person.
Well, that would be a huge honor. But, Rich, one of the things I was going to ask you is, how are you doing since your hip surgery?
Oh, God bless you. I was so lucky. It kind of came out of the blue, and they put in a new hip, and they did it. I think they did it in the morning, and I woke up about 2 in the afternoon, and I just expected, you know, to have the normal feelings you'd have after surgery. I haven't had much surgery throughout the years, but I just kind of figured, well, I'll give in for 3 weeks and fight it, and it'll be fine after 3 weeks. And I woke up, and everything was fine, if you can believe it. And was walking the next day and went home the second day, and it was one of these things that I'm afraid to even say anymore.
But it was
just a complete surprise, and I think they've got it down, you know, to where it's like changing a battery. These putting in a new battery, closing it up, and you've got a bright light. Yeah, with what you could have with, do like you say, with transplants and things. I guess we have to count our blessings, because if we get a good pitch, you know, you're not guaranteed of getting one the next time.
Yeah, that's true. Have you been able to get back on a horse since then?
Yeah, I sure have. Everything's normal. It's been about a year and 2 months. It's been about 14 months. And I don't even think about it, dear guy. Isn't that incredible?
Oh, that's terrific.
Well, Rich, let's talk about how you got started as a trail riding troubadour after the break. And we've also got a neat song from Ivan Danes, When the Spirit of the West Continues, right after this. Welcome back to the Spirit of the West. A couple of cowboys were chasing a renegade steer, and they got way more than they bargained for. And that story will be told in a song after we get back to Rich Price, on the line from the High Sierras in California. And Rich, how did it all kind of get started for you, this life of a riding, singing cowboy?
Gosh, from the time I was born, I just kind of communicated, I think, mentally and physically through our music. And I just remember living with Roy Rogers and Gene Autry and Jimmy Wakely and Tex Ritter and then Marty Robbins and Jim Reeves and Hank Snow and Rex Allen Sr. and so good to meet Rex Allen Jr. And I just grew up with it, and it's just our way of life. The words just to sing about the mountains and the trees and people and the movement west, you know, with people coming over from other parts of the world and landing on the East Coast and making their way across 3,000 miles across Canada and the United States and all of the adventures I had. And through all the years of doing that and the songs that went along with that, all led to what I've always loved in the way of having the songs, be a study of the human mind and history in giving us some insight into how the people felt at the time. And the wonderful part about our music is it's just a continuous way of communicating, I guess, with our fellow man, you know, through our songs. I've always felt there's the English language and many different languages, and my language, I think, of choice is the Western music language, and I use that, I guess, to get my emotional input and express myself.
Well, I've been looking at, naturally your album covers and your beautiful artwork and graphics and photographs and some of the outfits that you're wearing for the videos you do and different things look like they were kind of influenced by some of the wardrobe that Rex and Roy and Gene wore. I mean, wow, they are spectacular.
Oh, thank you so much, you and you're so right, and I love those clothes so much for what they represent, and I've always thought to myself that I would never wear them, you know, to be what you might call showy or decorative or as what you might call flashy show clothes. I wear them because of what they represent, and I try to very carefully design them myself, and I have them represent the great outdoors, and I try to give people through the what they see the feelings that we're trying to exchange together in our visits, where I sing our songs and I feel a pony beneath my legs, or you feel the stars and the sun, you know, and the sunsets and the sunrises.
Okay, well, if you can just hang on the line for a couple of minutes now. Ivan Danes is busy working on the 41st annual Ivan Danes Country Music Picnic at the Danes Ranch in Innisfail, and we'll be telling you more about that in the coming weeks. In the meantime, here's Ivan and the story of Jake and Roni.
Jakey and Roni was a riding along. Jakey was a singing what he called a song. When up from the gully, what should appear? An old mossback Suki and a bald faced deer. Jake took after with his hat pulled down. He built him a blocker that would stop a town. The steer he headed for the setting sun. Believe me, neighbor, he could hump it and run. Roni followed up his partner's deal. Just two old waddies that could head and heel. Both of them were working for the chicken coop with a red hot iron and a hungry loop. The sun was shining in old Jake's eyes. He wasn't looking for no big surprise. When the steer gave a wiggle like his shirt was tight, and he busted through the junipers and dropped out of sight. Jakey's horse done a figure eight. Jake done his adding just a mite too late. He went out of the saddle a seeing red, and he landed in the gravels of a dry riverbed. Roni's horse was a good horse too. He couldn't quite figure out why Jake flew. So he dumped old Roni where the ground was hard, and they both let out running for the home caviar. Jake set a holding of a swelling thumb. Said he, well, I reckon we was going some. But Roni, he hollered, get away from here. We're both going to tangle with that bald-faced steer. Roni clumb a straddle of a juniper tree. There's no more room up here, said he. Jakey, thinking himself too safe, he crawls in the opening of a cut bank cave. The steer he charged with his head way down, rolling his eyes and paw on the ground, hooking and a snuffing and a turning about, and every few seconds old Jake'd pop out. Roni said, you old fool, stay back out of sight. You act like you're hankin' for to make him fight. Jake, he hollered so the world could hear, stay back, nothing, there's a bear in here.
That's why he kept coming out of that cave. Well, let's get back now to the singing Sierran, Rich Price.
Sounds like you got a partner there that's doing some rehearsing in the background.
That's right. We've really got a friend here who would like to meet you. And this is kind of like you and I being out on a trail in the Sierras or the Blue Canadian Rockies.
Yeah, it's very authentic. All we need is some coyotes now.
I just can't wait to visit with you and hear about what you love and just seeing all the wonderful things you've done. And I just want to have you just share that with me so I can just live through some of these wonderful years and just can't wait to shake hands with you.
Well, I can't wait to do the same with you. Now, how long ago did you actually start doing these trail rides and entertaining the riders and doing it on horseback? How long ago did you start that?
Well, you know, I've done it all my life, and I was in high school. I went up to Northern California and took out trail rides and moonlight rides, and would play at night on a working ranch. During the day, we'd take out rides and sometimes ride 32 miles a day up into the granite mountains of Northern California, and then get back to the ranch. We'd start out at 5:30 in the morning on the trail sometime and get back about 6 in the evening and have dinner and then sing around a campfire for some of the guests at these working ranches and sing along with some of the other people that were working on the ranch, and I guess get to bed about 10, 11, 12, 1 in the morning, whenever we'd stop playing, you know, our music, which I guess in those days, God, Porter Wagoner had just come out with Satisfied Mind, and Ray Price was just starting out with Now Blue Ain't the Word for the Way That I Feel.
Mm, oh, my goodness.
Sweet Little Miss Blue Eyes was on the back of that. I was singing a lot of Hank Snow and Roy Rogers and Jimmy Wakely and Marty Robbins. I then went to Yosemite and spent 4 years taking out trail rides from possibly 8 in the morning till about 5 in the evening, and we'd ride sometime 32 miles a day, and it was the equivalent of 3,000 miles a summer. It was like getting on a horse in San Francisco in June and getting off in New York in September, and then we'd unsaddle the horses at 5 at the end of the day. There'd be about 20 wranglers and about 300 head of stock. There were horses, mules, and donkeys, and we'd unsaddle them, and then in the evening, I'd play for the wonderful tourists that were in Yosemite Valley from all over the world.
Yeah, sounds wonderful to me, Rich. Now, if you can hang on, we'll play another song of yours and visit some more in just a little while here. Baxter Black describes all of the things that can go wrong when you're calving heifers on the night shift, when the Spirit of the West continues right after this.
Howdy, friends. This is Baxter Black on Spirit of the West with Hugh McLennan with a little peek at the night man and the heifer lot. What holds the loaded 30,000-pound trailer to the heavy-duty truck? What holds the 38-foot RV trailer to the dually? What holds the 2-horse trailer with your daughter's favorite pony to the half-ton pickup? Well, the odds are it's a B&W trailer hitch, probably a turnover bow, American-made, employee-owned, customer-tuned, and proud of their part in America's greatness. B&W, holding things together down the road. I've calved a lot of heifers in my lifetime. It's something I enjoy, walking out on a clear, cold night amongst them, stars shining, aiming the flashlight in their direction, trying to spot something. Studying them a little while to see if they're actually started or if they're just uncomfortable and restless. This describes a typical night. I came on just after supper. Boss had fixed a little sheep camp with a bed and propane burner so a feller could have coffee in the middle of the night. On my first check, it was quiet in my bunch of calvy heifers, and the moonlight made the cedars look like postcards. I was thinking all was good and all was right. But at 10, I found 2 mamas with their water bags a-showing. They were off there in the corner, so I left them to their business and went back to fill my mug. In an hour, one showed progress. Heifers take a little longer, but the other needed checking, so I worked her to the calving barn and put her in a jug. Pulling calves is always chancy. Like you're playing slots in Vegas. Put your hand in, pull the lever, double front feet or the head back, nothing coming but the tail. But tonight my luck was running. Head and feet were pointing at me, so I chained him up and gently helped him make a change of address, like delivering the mail. I administered a rub down, swung him upside down a second, stuck a straw up to his nostril, watched him fill his lungs unaided with his first taste of fresh air. And then I loosed the heifer's halter. She was quick to start his lessons. Soon her baby found the fountain, tail a-ringing, he was sucking in his calfskin underwear. By coincidence, I noticed, back behind in yonder corner, that the other heifer also had her baby up and sucking, and was putting on a show. It was sort of satisfying. I admit I paused a minute to appreciate life's mysteries, although mostly I was thinking, only 96 to go.
This is Baxter Black
on Spirit of the West with Hugh McLennan.
Brought to you by B&W Turnover Bowl.
Last week. Was it last week? Yeah, I think it was. I played Ian Tyson's Springtime in Alberta. And now it's May in Alberta. It's May everywhere. And I can't pass up a chance to play this one, so just ahead of the Rangeland News, here's Alan Christie.
What's with the spring up here in Alberta? Weather don't know what to do. I'm just sitting here drinking coffee, trying to keep my mind off of you. Alberta, May, make up your mind. It's either cold as hell or warm sunshine. It's been a long, hard winter, but you can take the chill away. Alberta, May. Now I think I must be dreaming. There's snow falling down in May. I've got a lot of things I should be doing. I'd call you, but I don't know what to say. Alberta, May, make up your mind. It's either cold as hell or warm sunshine. It's been a long, hard winter, but you can take the chill away. Alberta, May. Now ever since you've been gone, there's been a cold front running. That old Chinook would be blowing if you just come back again. Alberta, May, make up your mind. It's either cold as hell or warm sunshine. It's been a long, hard winter, but you can take the chill away. Alberta, May, make up your mind. It's either cold as hell or warm sunshine. It's been a long, hard winter, take the chill away, Alberta, May.
Now the news of the Rangeland, a roundup of news and coming events from around the West. We'll tell you what's new under the western sky right after this word from the cattlemen of Western Canada.
Beef cattle ranching is an important part of British Columbia's economy. Most ranches are family-owned, operated by second- or third-generation ranchers. Together, they employ over 4,000 people, supporting communities and local businesses such as veterinarians, mechanics, truckers, and more. Beef cattle ranching truly provides economic stability to many BC communities.
Top of page one on the Rangeland News. Do you remember the 70s? A couple of things happened a lot of us were not happy about. One of them was beef consumption began to decline, and the other one was disco music. Well, here's Gary Crawford's perspective on the 70s and what's happening today.
The 1970s disco was king, so was beef. The average American in 1977 consuming just under 92 pounds of beef that year, only about 49 pounds of chicken. Then, as disco faded away, beef consumption was doing the same thing. To stem the tide, beef producers in 1991 launched this familiar ad campaign.
Beef, It's what's for dinner.
But Americans continue to eat less beef for dinner. In fact, the very next year, per-person consumption of chicken overtook beef for the first time. By 2015, per capita beef consumption was just under 54 pounds, a drop of 38 from 1977. But last year, a reversal. Beef production rises, retail prices drop by over 6%.
And I think that's helping support consumer demand for beef.
USDA livestock analyst Shale Shagam, indeed, last year, per-person consumption of beef actually went up by about 1.5 pounds to just under 55.5. The thinking is we might eat another pound more this year. Gary Crawford for the U.S. Department of Agriculture, Washington.
Well, I'm doing my part, Gary. Repercussions of drought conditions last year continue to be felt by livestock producers in many parts of Canada, and the federal government has expanded the designated regions eligible for tax deferral. Livestock producers in the designated areas who had feed shortages last year can defer some of their 2016 proceeds from sale of breeding stock until next year. Federal Agriculture Minister Lawrence McCauley said the deferral is designed to help livestock producers manage the impacts of drought and focus on rebuilding their herds this year. Areas added to the list include the Kitimat and Stikine regions of BC, the county of Newell, Mackenzie County, and the city of Calgary. 26 additional regions in Ontario, 9 in Nova Scotia, and 1 in Quebec. A real concern all over the West, wherever cities are expanding into farm and ranch land, is the loss of productive grazing and forage. And a recent study from the University of Alberta researcher Brent Swallow shows that farm and ranch land is still being paved over as urban development continues between Edmonton and Calgary. And the result is fragmentation and soaring land values as more people want to be close to a highway and the amenities of the city. His research found 3,127 square kilometers were taken up with a surge of development starting in 1984, and by 2013, the urban landscape had increased to 4,763 square kilometers. Land use changes to developed use was highest during the 1984 to 1992 period, and the greatest fragmentation of farmland has occurred around Edmonton, Red Deer, and Calgary. The slowdown in recent years was due to more intensive urban development within the city boundaries rather than farmland conservation. His work has also studied the value of agricultural land for the last 15 years and the costs of conservation. Producers in the prairie states and provinces don't have a problem with BHMD, also known as bovine high mountain disease and sometimes brisket disease, but it can be a problem in the mountainous areas. Well, how about this? Researchers at the University of Wyoming are working on an ongoing project to breed out the gene that causes high altitude sickness in cattle. They decided to breed male yaks with cattle because yaks are cross-fertile with cattle and are completely resistant to the disease. The yak cross calves, I bet they're cute. They display some similarities to normal bovine calves, and the researchers plan to challenge these calves at higher elevations in the near future. Coming up at the BC Livestock Co-op Yards in Kamloops, regular sale May the 16th. In Williams Lake, regular sale May the 18th and May the 26th in Vanderhoof. You can get all the information on what's coming through the ring at these sales at bclivestock.bc.ca. Meanwhile, across the Rockies, there are regular cattle sales every Wednesday and two horse sales a month at the Innisfail Auction Market. You get all the details on their sales at innisfailauctionmarket.com. And that takes us down to the final item. And this actually happened here at the ranch back about the 9th of March. That's Billy's birthday. And we'd gone out early to feed and check cows, and cow number 917 was trying to head off into the bush all by herself. She was obviously going into labor. So we got her penned up in the arena with a few other cows, and we went for breakfast, and then I was on the phone recording an interview that took a couple of hours. And when I finished, I said, "Billy, we better go check that cow. She was getting pretty close." And Billy said, "Check your email first." Now, her office and my studio and office, both upstairs, just across the hall from each other. And I said, "No, we got to check that cow." And Billy said somewhat firmly, "No, check your email first." I thought, oh man, this must really be important. Maybe a new sponsor or something. So I did check it. And there was a picture of 917 and a neat little black calf already up and nursing. And that's the Rangeland News. Next on the Urban Saddles and Western Wear Horse Training File, there's a right way and a wrong way to use your hands on the reins, and there's more from my guest Rich Price, too, when the Spirit of the West continues right after this. Welcome back to the Spirit of the West. The Irvin Saddles and Western Wear Horse Training File is coming right up, but first, I guess I'm about 2 weeks too late with this one, but it still fits, I think. Here's Charlie Ewing, and he's been there, and he's done that.
Well, it's the second day of April. Spring is here, I know. The north wind is a-howling. Another foot of snow. I got the mama cow blues. I got the mama cow blues. There ain't no rest for the weary. Ain't slept since yesterday. Most cows keep dropping babies. In the snowdrifts, not the hay. Got the mama cow blues. And I don't think they'll ever go away. Well, the first few cows that had their calves got by without a hitch. But number nine died upside down while calving in a ditch. I got the mama cow blues. I got the mama cow blues. Well, we pulled a dozen more since then. 20 got the scours. The sun came out a while today, but they're calling for more showers. Got the mama cow blues. And I don't think they'll ever go. Dropped her calf head first in a badger hole. Another's kicking her calf away with all her heart and soul. I got the mama cow blues. I got the mama cow blues. With all this snow and wind and sun, her udder's sore and raw. I become a firm believer in the words of Murphy's Law. I got the mama cow blues. And I don't think that ever. Summer sun is warm and the grass is growing green. With several hundred healthy calves, a pleasure to be seen. No more mama cow blues. No more mama cow blues. Well, I guess I know next April we'll be doing it again. For now, we'll just be thankful we got all that snow and rain. No more mama cow blues. And I didn't think they ever.
Now it's time for the Horse Training File, brought to you by Irvine Tack and Western Wear, Canada's largest Western store.
There is a right way and a wrong way to hold the reins in your hands, particularly if you're using a snaffle or a Bozell, and we'll talk about that right after this. At Irvine Tack and Western Wear, you won't find this.
Hey, y'all!
But you will find this.
Welcome to Irvine's. How can I help you?
You won't find this.
What size boots you wear there, boy? You got tiny feet.
But you will find this.
Absolutely, we have your size. In fact, I've got the perfect pair for you right here.
The one and only Irvin Tack and Western Wear. Something for everyone. Cowboys and cowgirls to city folks, too. It's Western Wear with a welcome twist. Off exit 305 on Highway 2 by Crossfield. Open 7 days a week.
Canada's largest Western store.
Something so simple, and yet it can make a huge difference in the way your horse responds to your rein crew cues. Here I'm talking about a horse that's in a snaffle bit or a bozelle and being ridden mostly with two hands. I've actually seen some riders with a rein in each hand ride with their thumbs pointing out, and for me, this makes it really difficult for the horse to understand the cue. The direction our thumbs are pointing, especially when it comes to lateral movement, but also when we're stopping, backing, or steering them straight forward, can make a huge difference. For example, when our thumbs are pointed out, our elbows are in next to our sides, and we're using our bicep muscles, and that means we're more likely to lock our arms and be pretty firm with our hands. Now, when the horse feels this, they usually will react by pulling against us, because their only choices are to either put their chin on their chest where they can't go any further, or pull an equal amount of pressure in order to maintain their head position and their balance. Now, when our thumbs are pointed in with our palms down, we're using more tricep and less bicep, making it less likely to lock our arms, and this as a result makes our hands softer, which is going to help maintain softness in our horses. I like to see riders develop a soft feel with each hand. For example, your right rein grasped lightly between your thumb and palm and running out past the outside of your little finger. And you can send the horse a soft but clear cue simply by keeping your arms and elbows still and slightly bending your wrist to the right or the outside. And this, of course, applies to both hands and both reins. I think it's really important to be able to recognize the slightest response from your horse and release when he responds, and if you can develop a real soft feel to your horse, he'll send that soft feel back to you, and that feels great. Something else that feels great to our horses is that daily feeding of Hoffman's Horse Ration, and you can find out more at hoffmanshorseration.com, and for Irvine Saddles and Western Wear, that's the Horse Training File. Rich Price, still on the line from the Sierra Nevadas of California, and Rich, on your latest albums, man, you have assembled a wonderful who's who of studio musicians, including a guy I think is one of the finest singers ever to record, and that's Ray Walker of the Jordanaires, but, oh gosh, there's so many more.
I guess all of our life, you know, we've heard Harold Bradley play on most every major record or well-known record that we've ever heard coming out of Nashville, and Ray Walker is just a beautiful piece of artwork. It was a thrill for me to get to meet him and know him and be able to call him friend. And another member of the Jordanaires currently is Curtis Young, and he's done just about everything. And he sang with the Willis Brothers back in the 80s, and did Charlie McCoy, wonderful
harmonica virtuoso, and Joey Miskelin playing accordion, man.
Yeah, there's no one like Joey, is there? He's just a genuine, wonderful human and cowboy, and we spent about 3 days from maybe 8 in the morning till 6 in the evening, and we'd get together, and we were all in one room in Nashville. And we did this for quite a few days in a row, and I'd sing a song, and we'd run through it, and then we'd record it, and we'd be together, and it was like being around a campfire with your best friends in a large living room, and we were just visiting and sitting there and singing our music with Harold Bradley on the guitar, Jimmy Capps on lead guitar, and Andy Reese on rhythm guitar. Charlie McCoy was playing his harmonica, and Joey was playing his accordion. And we had a wonderful drummer, Bob Matter, and a great bass player. And it was just like being around a campfire, or being out on a breakfast ride, or a ride at the end of the day, and just visiting with your friends and singing songs from the heart. It almost sounds like we're making this up, doesn't it?
But it's all true. And let's play another track with that great crew right now.
The
There's a place where peaks of granite gray reach up to heaven's blue, and the green pine trees encircle Dale of Gold. High above the valley, great and wide, neath the moon yellow and pale, I ride and sing along the Sierra Trail. My heart is light and free, and the breeze keeps saying to me, it's your home, boy, you couldn't ask for more. I answer with a song, I'll be happy just as long as I linger in the land that I adore. There's a silver star that beams and shines for me, it seems, and my Palomino pal will never fail. I've got chaps and spurs that jingle and a life that I adore as I ride and sing along the Sierra Trail. There's a little blue-eyed miss who's waiting just for me, or a silver cloud to her my heart will sail. And she's the one who makes my life complete as I ride to her along the Sierra Trail. My heart is light and free, and the breeze keeps saying to me, it's your home, you couldn't ask for more. I answer with a song, I'll be happy just as long as I linger in the land that I adore. As I linger in the land that I adore.
And Rich has a great website and Facebook page. You'll find his site at richpricethesinginsierran.com. Next, this week's classic Song of the West and the story behind the song, and we'll see if you can figure out who the singer is. Then Cowboy Poetry the Way It Should Be from Dave Longworth, when the Spirit of the West continues right after this. Welcome back to the Spirit of the West. This is where we take a look at an old classic Western song and try to find out a little more about it. Now, this one has been passed down through several generations orally through the true folk song process. The song was first known in at least five Canadian provinces before 1896. And finding this out led to speculation that the song was composed at the time of the 1870 Wolseley expedition to a valley in Manitoba. The earliest known written manuscript for the lyrics dates back to 1879. And the tune and the lyrics were collected and published in Carl Sandburg's 1927 book, American Songbag. In 1925, Carl T. Sprague, an early singing cowboy from Texas, recorded it as Cowboy Love Song. And this song has been a favorite on all of our Spirit of the West cruise sing-along sessions. And see if you can identify the singer on this version of our classic Song of the West, Red River Valley.
From this valley, they say you'll be going. I will miss your bright eyes and sweet smile. Say you'll be taking the sunshine that has brightened our pathway a while. Come and sit by my side.
So true. sit by my side ere you leave me. Do not hasten to bid me adieu. Just
have you figured out who that singer is yet? Well, if you said George Strait, you got it. Now, Dave Longworth has been writing and reciting good poetry for a long, long time, and he really has a gift for words. Always great to see him at the Kamloops Cowboy Festival. And here's Dave in our spotlight today.
My dad is a funny guy. He used to tell me, like, I have no acumen for machinery whatsoever. You know, if I can't do it with WD-40, duct tape, and vice grips, forget it, you know? And he used to tell me that, son, and I thought this was a wonderful compliment for years, he said, son, you know, hiring you is like three good men leaving. And as I got older, and he started to appreciate my literary bent, and he found out that I was doing cowboy poetry, and he said, well, that's good. He said, I'm glad to see you're keeping it on. He said, at least now you've found a way to wear all the clothes and do none of the work. You know, a farm kid on a ranch don't stand a snowball's chance of avoiding the other young bucks teasing. But I really didn't mind. For me, things were working fine. So their ribbon and their kidding was quite pleasing. You see, this outfit is the one to find out how it gets done. To learn to be a hand is why I'm here. And since signing on in spring, I've picked up many things. Though sometimes their meaning ain't exactly clear. But you find out later on, if you're quick and you catch on, that in time perhaps all will be revealed. Though certain information, aided, I'm sure, by imagination, is designed to keep some details concealed. Like if another hand kind of has it in his plan not to speak of what he's done or what is past, then you honor his request. It's a code here in the West, and you back his play up till the very last. Now, the peeler on this place was a man of quiet grace. He rode them all and wasn't prone to wrecks. He was top hand at his game. No one really knew his name. He simply introduced himself as Tex. And he kept his rigging in top shape. And he shrugged off every scrape. He was tough as nails. Just like I hope to be. Yet, he showed a gentle side after each bone jarring ride, when he'd calm and soothe every trembling pony. And he taught me many tricks, only once, and often quick. He said, getting good comes not from magic, but from doing. Keeping your deepest seat, knowing your pony's feet, the yups and nopes of bitting and of shoeing. And he called me kid, nothing more. Never talked about before, nor asked me one near thing about my life. And about him, all I knew, I'd gathered from the crew, that we hear he killed a man. Yeah, maybe gutted him with a knife. But they all knew his worth, and nothing on this earth could make him any less in their eyes. And then this new fella come on the place. Kind of got in everybody's face. Well, we reckon he's just trying to give himself some size. But he could palaver you near to death. Seemed he only run out of breath when old Cookie finally put him on the run. And that's when he spotted Tex. And we knew what was next and figured now we might be in for a little fun. Because Tex had just topped off a roan and had barely missed being thrown, so his demeanor wasn't exactly at its best. But this feller, just the same, barges up with, hey, what's your name? Well, we could tell old Tex was not impressed. He looked him up and down, and he said with a bit of a frown, Tex, and turned and walked away. But this feller wasn't done, and he hollers out, now, where are you from? or we all froze. He'd gone too far today. But Tex finished stowing his cack and then silently strode back. Louisiana, he said in an icy voice. Now this feller could have quit and just be done with it, but he kept it up. He'd made his choice. He said, you know, I've never traveled down that way, but I'll get me there someday, and you know, there's something that's got me all perplexed. I got a lot of chums named after where they're from. You come from Louisiana, how'd you come by Tex? Well, Tex's eyes got darker than smoke, and this feller looked like he might choke. He paled and went soft in the knees, and Tex fixed him with a stare that plumb prickled up my hair and said, I shot the only man that ever called me Louise.
Well, thank you so much for making the ride this week, and I sure hope you can join us right here next week at the same time when I plan to visit with the fine young working cowboy, outstanding bronc rider, and fast-rising Western music star, Matt Robertson. And thanks again to our great support crew. That would be Mark and Kathy McMillan. They own and operate a beautiful place called Meadow Springs Guest Ranch in the heart of the Caribou Country. Great place to spend some time. It's miles of beautiful trails to ride, and you're welcome to bring your own horse. And you can find out more at meadowsprings.com. And if you're looking for tractor parts, any make, any year, Mark can help you there at his website, bctractorparts.com. And you can get a real sense of cowboy life in the West in every issue of Canadian Cowboy Country Magazine. To subscribe, go to cowboycountrymagazine.com or just call 1-800-943-7336. Till next week, I'm Hugh McLennan. Hope to see you down the trail somewhere real soon.